Welcome. I'm Glen Anderson with the Olympia Fellowship of Reconciliation. For nearly 30 years, this TV series has explored a wide variety of issues related to peace, social and economic justice, the environment, and nonviolent social change. We especially provide opportunities for the public to hear voices and viewpoints that are rarely heard in mainstream media. The November 2016 election alarmed many people about serious threats to human rights, social and economic justice, the environment, and democracy itself. Our January 2017 TV program explores how ordinary people can boldly confront these new threats and also solve the problems that we have been experiencing for years. We can get through these hard times and create decent solutions if we recognize that we can indeed address problems effectively, and if we understand how nonviolent grassroots movements are powerful ways to achieve social and economic and political progress, and if we work strategically and nonviolently with other people to accomplish our goals. So we have two guests who will share their information and insights with us to help us explore this topic. I've known and respected both of these for decades. When I chose this topic, these two persons were the ones I thought of first that I most wanted to have as guests, and I'm delighted that both said yes. So I'm very happy to welcome Mary Lou Finley and Glen Gersmehl. Mary Lou Finley has a doctorate in sociology. She worked many years as a professor at Antioch University in Seattle. In the mid-1960s, she worked on Martin Luther King's staff in Chicago and has been active in many movements since that time, including the movements for women, peace, labor, racial justice, and against nuclear power. Mary Lou Finley co-authored a book titled Doing Democracy, which helps people organize nonviolently at the grassroots to achieve social and political change. She co-edited a 2016 book on the long-term impact and legacy of the civil rights movement in Chicago. Mary Lou Finley is a certified Kingian nonviolence trainer, and she has been conducting classes and workshops on nonviolence and social movements for many years with people of all ages. It's really going to be fun to have you here for this hour. Thanks, Mary Lou.
Thank you.
Glen Gersmehl also is an old friend. He's worked for decades for social justice and peace. He worked 7 years with the elderly in New York City's highest poverty and crime areas and worked skillfully to advocate, organize, and build social movements there and elsewhere. He's led 800 workshops and taught 9 college courses on peace and justice concerns. Glen Gersmehl directed the nation's largest community leadership training center, provided trainings for many prestigious national and international settings, and has been published in many impressive publications. He developed participatory computer-based activities used by 1 million people. He was the U.S. delegate to international meetings held in India to plan for the United Nations Decade for Peace. For many years, he has also worked as the national coordinator of the Lutheran Peace Fellowship, and he has significantly strengthened their organization and activities. It's great to have you here as again. You've been a guest a couple of times, and Mary Lou once about 15 years ago when this book came out, and we featured you and the prime author. So I'm happy to proceed with this. We're facing hard times, as I said in the welcoming introduction. Many people are saying that the 2016 election portends extremely serious dangers ahead for human rights, social and economic justice, the environment, the climate, escalating militarism, governmental corruption, and for democracy itself. And I wonder if each of you could just briefly say how you see our immediate situation, and perhaps even before the 2016 election, and what seems like we're in due for. Mary Lou, how do you see things?
Well, what I was thinking about before the 2016 election was that we were really in a period of movement growth. The Black Lives Matter movement was beginning to raise a lot of important issues affecting the Black community. We still are kind of in the tail of the work that was done by the Occupy movement in 2011, when they raised the question of economic inequality. We've seen the Arab Spring, we've seen movements around the world, so we've been in a very active time. And so in some sense, I'm seeing the reaction that we're getting now is a kind of backlash against really the kind of successes that movements were having up prior to the election. And I just would add one more thing that I think we have to watch out for is that our president-elect is quite a media star, and he's always saying something that somebody takes offense at, and I think that can be quite a distraction for us. So I think it's really important that we focus on the political issues that are going to be up here in the current time.
Great. Thanks, Brandon. Yeah. Glen, what's your take on things?
Yeah, I share 100% your enthusiasm for all of the movements you mentioned and others, Black Lives Matter, Occupy movements. And I think they've really broken some new ground. At the same time, I'm always struck when I'm out, you know, in the community, you know, doing workshops or just talking to people, working, you know, with like union people or people in churches, how many people really don't understand the issues that you're raising in this forum here. And part of the reason why I was so enthusiastic about joining you, that these are really answers and solutions and tools that are not that widely shared. And I'm just really hopeful that we can grab a hold of enough of that to make a difference in the coming period, because there's a lot that's pretty worrisome.
Yeah, great. Thanks to both of you. One of the things that happens when a disaster strikes, a natural disaster or a human-made disaster, is people will lament the horrible event, and there's a danger of just a lot of ain't it awful, ain't it awful, ain't it awful lamenting that can end up reinforcing our worst fears and sapping our energy, and it could crush the human spirit. It could inhibit us from taking the steps that we need. And so I'm looking forward to the things that you have to say, because I know both of you approach this in a very realistic way, not minimizing the problems, but seeing very solid, productive ways that we can move ahead. So let's start with that. I want to mention in that context this book, The Shock Doctrine, that was so powerful. Naomi Klein wrote this, and I read it. It's substantive, but very readable. The kinds of people who promoted the shock and awe to conquer Iraq in 2003 and to impose radical dominance and repression in other places in recent years, as Naomi Klein lays out in her book with many examples, are using shock and awe to assault us from all sides with the election and all the horrible cabinet appointments and other public policy agenda. And so I would urge people to read The Shock Doctrine and think about it. What danger do you see based on this kind of thing?
Well, as you mentioned, many of us are in shock at the results of this election. And the danger with that is that we become paralyzed and we just kind of deers in the headlights. And that is not what we need to do right now. We need to pull ourselves out of that with our friends, with our spiritual practices, however we can. We need to organize, and we need to be prepared to fight back as on behalf of social justice and on behalf of the environment, on behalf of racial justice, on behalf of the humane and humanitarian things that we all, that many of us care about, we need to be prepared to fight on that, on those fronts.
Uh-huh. Yes. Both of you have spent lifetimes, all three of us have spent lifetimes, working in grassroots organizing to change things. And Mary Lou, I wonder if you could talk about the power of movements organized in the grassroots, where that's what's caused the progress that we've made. None of the progress that we've made in our society or other societies have been gifts from the top down. Can you talk about the power of grassroots organizing movements?
Absolutely. Well, I guess my own experience when I was a young person, 50-some years ago, was with the civil rights movement. And I think that was, for our own American story, that was a very powerful example of grassroots organizing, which resulted in basic changes in the society. It was the grassroots organizing of the civil rights movement that resulted in the passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1964. It was the Selma campaign for voting rights that resulted in the Voting Rights Act being passed in 1965. So if it hadn't been for those campaigns, we wouldn't have got those changed laws, which have made an enormous difference. So that's one example. There's many, many more, but let's stop with what I can say that.
And the grassroots civil rights movement provided insights and empowerment and skills that led to the women's movement, that fed into the peace movement and environmental movement and stuff. So the movements build from each other and we learn from each other.
Yes, that was really important.
And I know that's been an important theme in the book, This is an Uprising by Engler and Engler,
yes. Mm-hmm.
Which is a wonderful book. Glenn, I wonder if you could tell us some insights into how you see voting in relation to democracy.
Yeah. A lot of people imagine that that's really the heart of democracy, that we all have a right to vote, and together we can choose the leaders and the leadership and the direction that our country goes. And I think it's really a shame that that's the way a lot of people, maybe most people, think of it, because it's the truth of the matter is voting is about 5% of democracy. It's community organizing, it's building grassroots movements, it's getting together and defining where things need to go and providing the shape of that direction for the elected officials. That is the way change actually has happened. You look throughout U.S. history, year after year, the changes that really mattered happened in that way.
Mary Lou, I wonder if you could give some insights into why grassroots organizing and movements need to be nonviolent.
Well, when you're organizing, we often organize in some ways targeting power holders. We want our city council, we want our president, we want our Congress to do something different than what they're doing. But actually, one of the main purposes of nonviolent organizing is, first of all, to awaken the general public to the issues that are at stake. And so if you're going to really try to reach a really broad range of people, nonviolence is really critical. People get, you need to be credible. You need people to hear what you have to say and think, this person is sensible. They're a leader. I can trust what they have to say. And holding the power of nonviolence really helps that whole process a lot.
It also makes it a safe space for somebody to join into.
That's right.
So if somebody's doing something and I'm afraid there's going to be violence there or extreme rudeness even, it's like, I don't want to be part of it. But if it's a safe space, then it's a place where not just like a few macho guys, but women, kids, elderly, mm-hmm. people with disabilities, people who are totally new to those kinds of mm-hmm. issues can feel safe coming in and having their safety and their humanity respected.
Yes, I think that's really right. And what that means is that you get a broader participation in the movement. And to build a movement, that's what you need.
Uh-huh.
More and more people joining up.
Right.
And so that's important about how you can get that. Yeah.
I wonder if you could explain, Glenn, something about how nonviolence works, how and why nonviolence is effective.
Well, part of it is that there's so many myths about it, that it's sort of weakness or You'll hear it on the media, this protest was nonviolent, and really all they mean is nobody was hitting each other, you know. And nonviolence isn't just getting the countries to stop fighting or the kids to stop fighting, if that's the level you're talking about. It's really building power. It's a different way of exercising power that ultimately is more effective than the heavy-handed kinds of power that we're so used to, and that a lot of people think is all there is. You know, the military or the, you know, political leaders coming down on something and demanding or pushing or making it happen in one way or another. Mm-hmm. And it's really people organizing. And there's just so many examples that I think you'll probably move us into.
We'll cover some.
Yeah.
I know one of the things that I like about, one of the many things I like about nonviolence is if you do it right, you're rewriting the script about what the conflict is about. Mm-hmm. So instead of the, you know, the top down, whatever, and fighting back with fists or something, it's like rewriting the script so the values come to life, mm-hmm. and so forth. I mean, there's just so much to this. Glen, tell us a bit more about the historical effectiveness that Gene Sharp. I want to show some things by Gene Sharp. I started reading his stuff in 1976. In the 70s, he came out with this amazing three-volume set of books about how and why nonviolence is a different way of doing a struggle, and the effectiveness of it, and that the second episode, the second volume in what I just held, lays out 198 different methods that he had documented over the years, and he said many more would be developed, and indeed they have. And then his work, I know I'm saying things that otherwise you'd be saying,
nope,
but the books
okay.
are here, they're props. He distilled some of his insights into how to resist dictators, and this short book has been translated into many languages and used all over the world to overthrow dictators nonviolently. Anyway, I wonder if you could respond to this sense, based on Sharp's approach, that nonviolence is a different kind of struggle.
Yeah, I mean, just think about the examples in history. I mean, an easy one is the American Revolution. Everybody imagines that it really was won by people getting their muskets and shooting at the British, and that more and more historians today are saying that's actually not true. That was sort of an afterthought almost. The colonists had actually won the American Revolution before the first bullet was fired at Lexington and Concord, with the Stamp Act and the boycott on the tea and so forth, the throwing the tea into the harbor. I mean, all of those things had brought the majority of the colonists together opposed to the British, and the British no longer had power anymore. And if they had known or had a leader like Gandhi or King or others to help, it could have moved without any violence toward a transfer of power, because they had essentially won the struggle at that point.
Yeah, and then as we Americans look back at our history and reflect on our national identity, instead of our heroes being guys shooting muskets, it would be people who boycotted.
Right.
People who set up a parallel court system and boycotted the British colonial court system in Virginia and so forth and so on. It would be just a whole different way that we would understand ourselves as a nation, mm-hmm. as a people.
Right.
So there's so many resources. This series, this book, A Force More Powerful, documents about a dozen or more historical cases of nonviolent organizing, nonviolent movements to protect human rights, overthrow dictators, and so forth. And it's in a videotape series and a DVD series as well. It's a great resource called A Force More Powerful.
Wonderfully done, really.
Yeah, it's amazingly informative and inspiring. Can you tell us some more, Mary Lou, about anything else about Gene Sharp's work?
Well, one of the things that stood out to me was that he really focuses on strategic nonviolence. He really is saying nonviolence. I mean, some people, you know, I'm a sort of connected very much to Martin Luther King's work, but from him, nonviolence was a matter of principle, and it had to do with love and caring about people. Gene Sharp doesn't deny that, but he says, you know, it works. That's what, and you don't have to have a spiritual underpinning for it. Just know that it works. And so, and he explains very well. He has one little part. He talks about a kind of political jujitsu that nonviolence does. It's how, why it works. So, and you know, it makes us aware that leaders need followers to cooperate with what they want us to do. And that becomes one of the powers of ordinary people, to not cooperate with things that we think are wrong and are unjust.
Yeah, and we'll revisit that a bit later on in the program, because there's a whole lot that we can learn from that for our current time, as well as other movements, you know, historically and worldwide. In 2011, Erica Chenoweth and her co-author Maria J. Stefan co-authored this amazing book that, in contemporary years, decades after Gene Sharp, was able to just substantively prove that nonviolence works better than others. They documented basically all of the conflicts during the 1900s, that whole century, and found that the ones that were exclusively nonviolent had a much greater likelihood of prevailing than those that had some violence in there, what's commonly referred to as diversity of tactics, where you're not limited to nonviolence. Nonviolence actually works better than diversity of tactics. And that when they prevail, you're more likely to come out with a better result, because you've had more kinds of people involved, and you've had, as you've said, Mary Lou, the broader range and more of that. Can you add anything else to this?
Well, I'm struck by how many other people had been doing that kind of research. What was remarkable about hers was both how systematic it was. I mean, academics have all said, you know, this is really solid.
Yeah, the methodology really impressed me.
But it was also that she didn't believe that nonviolence was the most effective. It really took her research to, like, gradually turn her mind around to realize, my goodness, this is astonishing what this data is showing, that nonviolent movements have been more effective, like twice as effective as ones that had any level of violence involved in them. And it's really done a lot to help bring more people in the universities and so forth around to understanding that this is something worth paying attention to.
Yeah, I might speak to the other point you were raising about how when it's all over, if it's been nonviolent, you're in a better place as a society.
Right.
I had a student a few years ago from Nepal, and his family had been involved in the peace movement in Nepal. And finally, at that point, there'd been a Maoist rebellion, and finally they had sort of come to some truce. The Maoists had said, okay, they were laying down their arms, they're going to be elected to parliament, they're going to participate in the government, which is what they wanted. So the whole thing was kind of over. But he said what happened was, after 10 or 20 years of so much violence, people fighting each other all the time, there was so much more people, the young people learned that violence is how you solve things. And so you were getting more abusive children, more domestic violence, more people killing their friends. It's like you infuse violence. A violent rebellion infuses violence in the whole society in such a way that it's very hard to get it out of there, even when the conflict is actually over. And so nonviolence does not give you that problem. Yeah. And that's a really important thing for how a society that has shifted can go forward in a peaceful way.
Yeah, and look how different it would be if you had a society that had been practicing nonviolence in their liberation struggle, and maybe that would be infusing the nonviolence and
the shared humanity into the society in ways that would give better results.
Yes, it's much more powerful.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. A lot of people assume that that nonviolence can work only against oppressors that are not really very nasty, and that nonviolence is not strong and effective enough. And of course, we've debunked the notion that it's not strong and effective enough. But people always ask, you know, what about Hitler? What about Hitler?
Yeah.
You know, that's just the classic.
Well, I felt that way too. That's the way I grew up. And it's astonishing. We made actually a list of 160 different stories of nonviolence throughout history. And it's astonishing how many of them are really violent. And just to take the Nazis, for example, after the war, the U.S. leadership got their smartest strategists to interview Nazi leaders, and the Nazi leaders admitted they had a lot easier time with the violent resistance that they got from groups like the Yugoslavs than from the nonviolent groups like Denmark and Norway and Sweden, where, for example, all of the teachers would go on strike when they were asked to teach Nazism in the schools. And once they had larger and larger numbers of people supporting them in those kinds of protests, the Nazis just threw up their hands. In fact, they actually emailed back, or in the version that they had then, the telegraph back to Berlin and said, we don't know what to do with this.
Yeah, I've seen quotations with that kind of stuff.
It's and you can find that in so many different movements, you know, the anti-apartheid movement in South Africa, you know, there are just numerous examples.
Yeah. There are a number of myths and misunderstandings about nonviolence, and I think you've touched on this already earlier, Glen, that nonviolence is not simply about just not physically fighting in the current moment. Can you help us understand nonviolence in the more profound way, other than just, well, I didn't hit the guy?
Yeah. Well, for one thing, there's a lot of strategizing and thinking and experimenting that goes on, and the smart movements do it step by step. They'll try things that they think will work and then build on that and use the successes to reach out and tell other people, hey, this is gonna, you know, make a difference. Look what happened here. And to gradually get larger and larger numbers of people, being willing to reach out beyond the people that you already know and that already support you to people that you might have a lot of differences of opinion on other things, but who you can bring in to support a particular change that needs to happen in the society. And ultimately, there's just so many examples of, like the title of that series, A Force More Powerful. That was actually Desmond Tutu's term. Nonviolence is a force more powerful than violence. And I still, because I grew up with the opposite view, I still find myself kind of astonished that how can that be? But in fact, you look at the evidence, and that's what's there right in front of you.
Yeah, it sometimes gets referred to as a third way. You don't have like fight or flight. People are taught from early age that you either fight or run away.
Right.
Well, there's this other way to prevail, and that's to use nonviolence and to be pretty savvy about it.
And that's part of the problem, that our educational system and our media 99% of the time will describe a situation with that kind of stereotype. And it really throws upside down this notion that we have a democracy. I mean, if a real democracy would be teaching people the skills and the stories and the examples and the ways of using people power, democracy power, to change things, and not just, like you described, the sort of top-down military force or whatever.
Yeah, look how many movies end with a car chase or blowing things up or a shootout or the old westerns with the shootout on Main Street. And this has been referred to as the myth of redemptive violence, that when things get really tough, violence is what'll save the day.
Right.
And we're so programmed with movies, and it's written into our foreign policy and everything else.
Right.
And nonviolence says you can actually win, make progress without using violence.
Right.
And people just can't imagine
just
that.
Our
imagination is so truncated
right.
that we're stuck in fight or flight.
I mean, even parenting. You know, I was lucky that I was became a parent late in life, and I watched all my friends struggling more than I wanted to, and ultimately to discover that there are ways to raise a child where you, I mean, I never hit my son. Mm-hmm. You know, we hardly ever disciplined him. What we would do is connect with him and work with him and find out what way was going to really work better. And mm-hmm. invariably, it was a way that made sense. And his teachers are impressed with that. You know, he's not faking it. He's just a, you know. We're talking about a whole lot of different parts of our life that this is true about.
Yeah. Mary Lou, I want to check in with you about using nonviolence in a strategic way instead of just like doing one thing after another that are disconnected. People who are upset by political or social injustices often vent frustration and mm-hmm. vent anger. Venting is not enough, and some of the ways that people vent, of course, backfire. And so instead of merely venting, we need to strategize and organize nonviolent movements. And it's not just like doing one random action after another, mm-hmm. but doing things with smart strategies for nonviolent campaigns that build. Can you tell us something of this?
Well, I want to pick up on the way that you put that together at the end about nonviolent campaigns. I think that's how we need to think about it, not just an action, mm-hmm. not just a statement, not just a venting of our upset, although sometimes we need to do that, but that's not going to really take us very far. Mm-hmm. That what we really need to do is to think about, okay, what is our goal? What do we want out of this? We want to protect Social Security. We want $15 minimum wage. We want some very specific things, and then begin to think about how to organize strategically to get to that point. One of the things that we talk about in the Martin Luther King version of nonviolence that I teach is there's steps to a nonviolent campaign. The first one, information gathering. Figure out what's going on. The second one, educate yourself and your colleagues about what's going on. The third one, personal commitment. Figure out what you're willing to do. How many are people willing to go to jail? Nobody can do that. Is it too scary to even go on a demonstration? You need to size up where your group of people you're working with, what they can commit to and what they can't commit to, and then come up with some strategies that work out of that. Mm-hmm. Then you go to negotiate with the people you're talking, you're concerned about, you're upset with what they're doing, you go talk to them. Okay, if sometimes talking to them works. Sometimes I'll say, oh yeah, you're right. I mean, we all hope that's what's gonna happen mm-hmm. when we go to talk to our city council person, but sometimes it doesn't. Then you think about direct action mm-hmm. after that and to get you back into negotiation. So you have to have a process that you're going through yeah. That builds a nonviolent campaign.
And to welcome the incremental steps mm-hmm. that you can build on. So yes. Like you mentioned city council. So if you have a city council member who's actually on your side, okay, there's an ally you can work
yes.
with.
Yes.
And
yeah,
that person okay. will have insights about how to do others. I know, and you know, so.
That's great, yes, yeah, yes, yeah, yeah. yeah. That's part of the information gathering and education. Starting out, okay, where are we on this
yeah.
question?
Yeah. You co-authored this book, and when it came out 15 years ago, we had you and the main author as guests on our program. And it mentions, to some extent, a model called the Movement Action Plan, mm-hmm. which is a great model beyond what we have time to discuss here. But I wonder, can you give us the basic sense of it in just 2 minutes?
Okay, well, let me try to be quick about it. So the main part of the MAP model, as we call it, is the 8 stages of a nonviolent campaign. And I'm not going to go into all the details, but the first 3 are kind of preliminary steps, small steps that you can do with small numbers of people. What you're hoping for is that your movement takes off. And if your movement takes off, somehow you've got the attention of the general public. Mm-hmm. You may not have people on your side, but they're thinking, oh, well, something's wrong here. What is it that's wrong? People start asking questions. And so that at least you're getting the issue on the public agenda. And that often takes big nonviolent actions. Mm-hmm. But what it's really important from the MAP model is that most campaigns do not win at that point. You woke people up, but you're not at success. And so the next step that you have to go through is beginning to reach out to new constituencies. Suddenly you've gotten a lot of people woke up and said, well, something's wrong here. I don't know what it is. You know, when there were protests against the World Trade Organization in Seattle back in 1999, people would say, well, what is this globalization thing that they're, what are they upset about? And the newspapers would start researching and they would tell some of the stories. So the movement didn't even have to do all the research and education, because once you get people interested in the topic, other people will help with that part of the process. but the next stage after takeoff is really trying to build new constituencies. One of my stories I like about this was one of the early climate change groups back in Vermont, way back about 10 years ago, they decided that they were going to reach out to, it was a kind of environmental group who was concerned. They were going to reach out to the snowmobilers because now environmentalists and snowmobilers are not always on the same page as to what should be going on in the out-of-doors. But if you talk to the snowmobilers and you say, you know what, if this global warming gets too bad, there won't be any snow in Vermont, they're interested. You get their attention. Yeah. And so they made alliances between the snowmobilers and the environmental movement to work together on climate change issues.
Yeah.
So... that's the kind of thing that you need to have after your movement takes off. You need to be reaching out to new kinds of people who weren't in your movement to start with. And as that process builds, then you can begin to have some successes, maybe at a local level, but eventually, hopefully, at a national level.
Right. And you mentioned that at the stage where the movement really takes off and all of a sudden the public discovers this, you mentioned that's not when victory comes. We don't win at that point. And we need to move on with majority public opinion coming onto our side. We need to find ways to do that. And there's the danger of the opposition fighting back. You get a backlash, or people get frustrated because we don't win right away at that takeoff stage. So it takes constant strategizing and staying grounded in the nonviolence and in the strategy and being flexible to change strategies to work
with different groups.
Uh-huh. But it's being savvy all the way along, and it's always doing things that'll bring more people in, and until it's very clear that what needs to get done. And when I talk with folks about this kind of stuff, I'll mention that when I was in college, people smoked in the college classroom. And nobody would question it. And that doesn't happen now. There's all kinds of stuff. When I first started looking for jobs, the Help Wanted ads in the newspaper, they had a column, Help Wanted Men for men's kinds of jobs, Help Wanted Women for women's kinds of jobs. And the newspapers were unwittingly perpetuating the stereotypes, and nobody was questioning this.
Mm-hmm.
You look at whatever kind of injustice or problem is out there, part of it is getting it onto the public agenda, as you said, and then organizing from there. But it's amazing how much progress we've made on those kinds of things in just the last 50 years.
Yes, I just want to say about the Help Wanted ads, it took the women's movement to get that to change. It wasn't that the newspaper suddenly woke up one day and said, this seems weird. No, they didn't. People pressured them.
That's right.
And eventually they changed because they began to see that it was kind of silly.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, the slogan out of the women's movement says the personal is political.
Mm-hmm.
It's like your experience, you know what your experience is, and it's part of this political context. And so we got to deal with these realities of the society as a whole.
Yes. We have to take our personal problems, as the old sociologists used to say, and see them as public issues.
That's right, yeah.
You know.
So that I appreciate your insights and your direct hands-on experience with, with all these things. So this raises the issue then about how do we bring new people in, and once we've brought people in, how do we keep them in? I wonder, Glen, if you could share some insights into how to bring people in to the movements and how to keep them in.
Well, it's interesting because a lot of it is very, very, very basic. Particularly now with all of the social media, one-to-one contact is often really essential for most people to connect. And so, you know, doing leadership training where your core people understand that sure, get the word out, and if people, you know, respond to that, great. But a lot of it is really that connecting with people and building relationships mm-hmm. and building the kind of sense of trust in a movement where you are truthful to each other, where you're supportive of each other. And that setting is actually pretty attractive for the next level of people to come in, because they look at that and that they don't see that very much in their life. And it's for many people, it's a really inviting kind of a piece of the puzzle.
So like a sense of community where you really belong,
yeah, exactly.
and you're valued mm-hmm. and
right.
respected as a person.
Right, exactly.
Yeah, you don't get that digitally.
Yeah.
You got to be face to face.
And I must say, with my experience with movements, I have really found that the people that I've connected in that way are very dear to my heart and close to me over long periods of time. And sometimes I've been at actions or something where I don't even know the people very well, but I feel like I know them because we share some really deep values. Mm-hmm. And so it creates a different kind of community than lots of other things. It's a very powerful kind of community.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Let's see. Thomas Jefferson recognized that we the people create the government, and we the people can change or even replace the government. And likewise, Gene Sharp's research shows that powerful oppressors lose their power when people refuse to obey them, and you've mentioned this already, mm-hmm. Or people at least, if they don't exactly refuse to obey, they at least withdraw their consent in tacit ways, of various kinds of ways, symbolic ways. And so an important part of Gene Sharp's advice is figure out how people can withdraw their consent. And I wonder, can you play with that notion, explore some possibilities, insights?
Well, if I go back to the civil rights movement and people trying to register to vote. There was a system set up where you would go and try to register, and they would ask you what were the Mississippi State Constitution say about this, or what was whatever. And you couldn't answer it. Oftentimes, people couldn't answer. They were kind of ridiculous questions. Mm-hmm. So the expectation was you were going to go away, and that would be that. Withdrawing consent is like, we're not just going to go away. We're going to do something else instead. And we're going to organize people around that. So that was like one kind of example. Mm-hmm. Do you want to come up? Do you want to speak to that too?
Well, there are just so many that come to mind. But ultimately, it's helping people understand what holds together the authority that is in front of you. And oftentimes, it's remarkably thin. And to find that vulnerable spot, and like you've said several times, you know, putting together the strategy to move people together and build support, reach out to new people, and ultimately to then challenge that. And that in turn brings on some additional support, and things start changing.
I think boycotts are a kind of example of withdrawing mm-hmm. consent. Nobody can say, I have to buy this thing. And so if I decide I'm not going to buy it, well, and collectively we're not going to mm-hmm. do something, then that can have an impact.
Yeah, really.
Back in the late 60s, there are a couple of occasions where athletes either raised a fist at the time yeah. of whatever, national anthem or yeah. Pledge of Allegiance, whatever that was at the end of some sports event. And there have been some times lately where athletes yeah. have, recognizing the racial injustice, police shooting African Americans, for example, or other things where they would not stand for the national anthem, or where they would mm-hmm. Wear a T-shirt as they came out onto the basketball court, mm-hmm. wear a T-shirt mm-hmm. with a message that was pretty explicit about what was happening. And that's kind of a way of defying authority or refusing to be nicely obedient and invisible. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, there are just lots of ways. I mean, a little kid who wants to throw a tantrum and embarrass mom at the grocery store when you're 3 years old, you know, very often gets his way. Now, that's not a great method, but even a 3-year-old can carry a lot of clout in something, and how much more if we were to do things in a, in ways that, that, that aren't tantrums, but are attention-getting in some mm-hmm. way of
right.
refusing to go along, refusing to obey. There's a model that I want to just share with folks that draws upon this sense, and I'll show this thing and then tell what it is. There's a model referred to as the pillars. If you think of like this old Greek or Roman temples or buildings where there's some columns and they're upholding a big horizontal piece that's like the front roof of it. And like if the big roof piece is some oppressive system, like in this case on this page it's death penalty, or it could be criminal justice system overall, mm-hmm. or it could be whatever. What are the pillars that prop it up? What are the systems, the institutions, the attitudes, whatever? And so like for death penalty, fear of criminals props up death penalty. Psychological needs for retaliation and vengeance prop up the death penalty. Racism props up the death penalty. The public's failure to pay attention to the realities and injustices that lead to crime prop up the death penalty. Self-serving politicians who are tough on crime when they campaign. All these are pillars that prop up the death penalty. And so this model says, what if we were to remove or weaken the pillars that prop up this oppressive system? And if you weaken or remove enough of them, that top piece is going to collapse. And that's just one example. This page is just death penalty, but it could be, you know, what props up the violent foreign policy that the U.S. has? Mm-hmm. You know, what props up housing discrimination on the basis of race, where mm-hmm. some people are not really allowed into some other neighborhoods to buy a home and so forth. You could take any kind of an oppressive system and think, what are the pillars that prop that up? And how can we organize to weaken these pillars? And I just find this to be a powerful model, one of many models out there to help mm-hmm. people strategize and think that may be suited better for some campaigns than for others.
Right.
One thing I like about that model is that you can kind of go, if you've got a really intense oppressive system, you can kind of go at it indirectly. You mm-hmm. don't have to confront the worst part of the system and the most intense part of it right away. And sort of peeling off some of the allies that support that system, for instance, is one one way to go about it.
Yeah, there might be some people who support it, but if they were weakened by an economic boycott, they might say, okay, well, you get this with businesses that have supported really horrible public policy. Uh-huh. And people say, all right, we're just not going to buy your product anymore. We're not going to shop at your chain store because you had this bad policy of mm-hmm. discriminating in your staff or mistreating mm-hmm. the hourly workers or whatever. And all of a sudden, whoa, you know, yeah, mm-hmm. yeah. All these things that we've been talking about lead us to recognize that the problems that we face, the real problems, are not just this individual politician or this individual political party, where all you have to do is replace this bad politician with somebody else and then problems are solved, or get rid of this party and elect that party instead, because these problems are long-standing and very much entrenched. And so it's not a matter of replacing one politician or one party with another, but there are systems and institutions that are beholden to money and abuses of power and so forth. So we need to examine all of that. And I wonder, can you give us any more insights? I'll look at you first, maybe look at Mary Lee next.
Well, I just think of one of the most challenging things we face is climate change, because there are just large numbers of people that say, well, the proof isn't in yet, you know? Mm-hmm. And it's remarkable, because if you dig into it a little bit, just take what a lot of people think of as a really conservative institution, the military. The military has become absolutely clear that they consider climate change a threat, and they have detailed plans on how to handle it with countries where it's going to affect, you know, rising waters in like Burma or whatever. And it's just... it's sort of broadening the scope a little bit and hearing some other voices that maybe don't really want to talk about it. But I have a whole bunch of friends who are sailors, you know, fishermen going up to Alaska and so forth. And a bunch of them have been very negative about all of this stuff on climate change. But in the last 4 or 5 years, particularly going back even 7 or 8 years, they're saying, they come back and they say, the ice is melting. You know, it's going to disappear before long. It's just right in front of you. How can people say that this is, you know, argument? Well, part of the reason is, you know, you go back to, let's say, smoking, you mentioned. Mm-hmm. The tobacco companies lobbied and put a lot of money into convincing people that there wasn't proof that right. cigarettes cause cancer. Well, that oil companies have literally bolstered research that tells people that it's not really for sure yet, you know, and we don't know yet. We don't have time to not know yet, you know. And if the military has decided it's happening, you know, like there's even a joke about getting people together to come up with a new name for the Glacier National Park, because in another 15, 18 years, there won't be any more glaciers there. And, you know, for a lot of people in Montana and, you know, some of these other states where you don't think of them as really radical and so forth, they see it, you know, they know it's happening. But you don't hear that, right. You know, it's not newsworthy, apparently. Yeah.
Do you have anything brief to add to this?
I think I'll just move on. Let's go on.
Okay. Yeah. I want to take us beyond the discussions we've had about what we don't like and how to get rid of what we don't like and look at what we want instead. And there's kind of a hinge point there if we were to look at the concept of shalom, which you can tell us the weak translation that we have as peace, but it's broader than that. Because if our nonviolence is really, if we can think of nonviolence in the shalom concept, then that moves us toward what we want instead. Tell us about shalom.
Yeah, I grew up, you know, where we went to church and heard the Bible and so forth, and it was just a shocker to have people that study the language to describe to me the actual word that the prophets and the disciples and Jesus and the early church used to say that we translate peace actually meant more than that. It actually fully included our concepts of justice, of welcoming community. Wholeness is one of the definitions you see in all of the dictionaries. And that changes a lot because, you know, peacemaking isn't just stopping the fighting, you know. It's changing the structures that have caused that to be the problem that it is. It's understanding the connection between injustice and violence and conflict and addressing those and solving the problem, not just papering it over.
So if that's the case, then shalom is more than just peace, and it leads us to think of a bigger vision of what nonviolence is. And if we were to look at that positive vision of nonviolence and shalom and say, let's organize for that, then where does that go? And you might think of Gandhi's constructive program as an example, but tell us, keep the conversation going.
Yeah.
And we are tight on time.
Yeah. Well, so. I think you just said it. I mean, the idea that, like he would, use this loom and work on it every day almost as a hobby, but it was a part of his understanding of change that people would retake some of the things that had been taken over by the British and the, you know, the imperial power, like weaving cloth,
right.
And take that back, take those skills back, take those activities and make them community rather than the other.
Yeah, his sense of independence was not merely political independence from the British Empire, but a more profound independence that he referred to as Swaraj,
day-to-day.
Which has to do with day-to-day local empowerment at the village level and all the positive stuff in his constructive program, which included equal rights for women and public health concerns and adequate nutrition and all the positive stuff. So he had a very encompassing positive vision. Anyway, we got to move on. We're almost done. I want to just highlight some resources. And we don't have time to do much here at the last couple of minutes of the program, but we will have listed in the closing credits and on the TV program part of www.olympiafor.org. We'll have a lot of resources listed, so look for those. We've mentioned a number of books, Doing Democracy, Gene Sharp's books, Erica Chenoweth and Maria Stefan book. There's a lot of resources at the nonviolence part of www.olympiafor, and I encourage that. There's some great nonprofit groups, Nonviolence International at www.nonviolenceinternational.net. There's the International Center on Nonviolent Conflict at www.nonviolent-conflict.org. Campaign Nonviolence is part of Pacha Ebene. The Gene Sharp's writings and other related work are at the Albert Einstein Institution, www.aeinstein.org. I really like the recent book by Engler and Engler called This Is an Uprising, that looks at a lot of the movements that we've talked about and others, show how they learn from each other and keep grounding themselves in really good practical nonviolence and achieving great results. I'd be happy to meet with folks, put on workshops or whatever. We did mention A Force More Powerful, the book with case studies,
stories,
and video and DVD. I really like the resources you have at the website for the Lutheran Peace Fellowship, www.lutheranpeace.org. People can click the resources link and then click the nonviolence link there, and there's just a lot of great stuff there. So I really encourage people to do that.
A lot of leaders' guides, for example.
Pardon me?
A lot of leaders' guides for leading a workshop on different things.
Yes, do that in your local faith community or your nonprofit group.
And the great thing is a lot of these resources are short. You know, you don't have to read a thick book to learn this stuff. In fact, I've read most of what you've got on your website, and that's really one of the best places to start.
It is. The nonviolence part of www.olympiafor.org.
Olympia, right?
Really great stuff. Yep. I like this. One of you brought this to share tonight. This is from War Resisters International. I read this when it came out a few years ago. Very practical handbook for nonviolent campaigns.
Short.
Really practical and grounded in good nonviolence and practicality. And I like your book, Doing Democracy. I've not yet read your new book on the civil rights movement, but I will in Chicago. In the November 2016 election, the American people vigorously rejected what they perceived to be the status quo. And we can reject the status quo and choose a better future, but the ways of doing it have to be nonviolent if we want to be effective and if we want to bring more people in and really create something. And instead of letting bad news overwhelm and disempower us, we need to think clearly, devise smart, nonviolent strategies, organize from the grassroots up. And I invite people to get information about this and other issues related to peace, social justice, and nonviolence through the Olympia Fellowship of Reconciliation. So thank you so much. We're all one human family. We all share one planet. We can make the world a better place, but we all have to work on it, and the world needs your efforts. Thanks for helping.